Good afternoon, everyone. So we'll make a short presentation and follow that with a panel discussion. So the first question that comes to everyone's mind is, what is really cross-sell? And I think there are two different types, and it's useful to make that distinction. There is cross-sell of existing bank products to customers, that's sort of type one. And then there is cross-sell of third-party products to existing customers. And as most practitioners will tell you, the second type of cross-sell, where you're trying to sell third-party products to existing bank customers, is often a lot tougher. And if you can sort of solve for that, then the first one is also something that you can do. So for the purpose of this discussion, I'll focus on the second type of cross-sell, which is cross-selling third-party products. The question that, given everything that's going on in the industry, that everyone sort of ends up asking is, there is a busy executive agenda, NPS on everyone's mind. Is cross-sell really worth paying attention to? Why would a bank executive, a senior executive, or the board spend time thinking about cross-sell? And what's happened over the next many years is that cross-sell has moved from being a footnote to being a very important part of how the banks think about their business. It's a very important source of profits. Where banks have taken a lead and set up subsidiaries, it has also become a very important part of the bank's overall valuation. And last but not the least, cross-sell is also a very important source of customer loyalty. Whenever a bank is able to sell multiple third-party products, you typically find that customers maintain higher balances and they tend to stay with the bank a lot longer. So cross-sell is quite an important part of the executive agenda. If you look at some of the numbers, we picked two banks, SBI and ICICI, and we looked at, from a valuation point of view, if you just look at these, the contribution of subsidiaries, it's actually quite meaningful. 30% in case of SBI, 45% in case of ICICI. Now one could argue that the valuations of banks are a little bit depressed, but even if you were to change the base valuations for the banks outside of subsidiaries, these numbers are quite material, and hence it ends up becoming quite an important part of the executive agenda. You look at the profit numbers, SBI last year, FY18, had about 1600 crores coming in from commission income, SDFC about 2000 crores, ICICI about 1100 crores. These are large numbers, and I think what is also heartening is to look at just the growth rate, anywhere between 50% to 100% growth rate in these numbers over the last year. The other aspect that one would focus on is this a one-time growth? Actually, the penetration of most of the products today in India is actually quite small. You look at life insurance, you look at GI, you look at AMC, as a proportion of GDP or as a proportion of the population, the numbers are quite small, thus giving us a confidence that these growth rates are not a one-time growth rate. There is actually sizable opportunity left, and for many years, cross-sell will continue to drive the economic profits for the banks. If everything was that easy and the opportunity was real, why aren't banks going out and sort of getting all of this done in a short period of time? Now, there are many challenges. This picture may be familiar to most of us. You walk into any bank branch, public sector, private sector, typically the branch staff will tell you they are very busy, there are too many things going on, they have many challenges that they end up tackling with. And there are four challenges that I think they will often tell you that are quite important for them. One is a busyness challenge. You wouldn't find a ground staff which has time on its hands besides completing the operational job, then they start thinking about sort of banking products, and then, if at all, the cross-sell ends up coming to people's mind. The second important challenge is, while most bankers understand their own products really well, the understanding of third-party products tends to be uneven. There are some bankers which will understand it quite well inside the branch. There are many that will not be able to tell you the difference between a debt mutual fund and an equity mutual fund, between one kind of life insurance policy and another kind of life insurance policy. So the question of what should I sell ends up being quite quite high on everyone's mind. If I understand the products, the next question that comes to people's mindsets, I will find the time for it, I know what to sell, but how do I go about making that sale? Especially when branches are overcrowded and there are too many things going on, this ends up being quite an important challenge. And last but not the least, and this is often underappreciated, a lot of branch staff really worries about the fact that even if I sell you the health insurance policy, the life insurance policy, the mutual fund, everything that starts from there on becomes their headache. If there is an accident in someone's family, the first person that gets contacted often is the branch staff. If the stock market falls and there is a concern on the NAV of the fund that got sold, the first port of call often is the branch staff. So this then becomes quite an important challenge. So this, while it's a sizable opportunity, there are some very, very important challenges that must be overcome for this to become a reality. We have a distinguished panel, and we'll all hear from them on sort of what are they doing in their respective institutions, how are technologists helping with this journey. But here is our perspective. There are four very important building blocks that need to be in place for cross-sell to really work. First, and this is the most important, very hard to sort of create very hard to create a cross-sell success story if it doesn't happen, is commitment from leadership. It is a complex problem, and if the bank's executive team is not fully committed to it, it just doesn't happen. No matter how much investments you make in technology, how much investments you make in analytics, it is not going to happen if it is the 37th page on the agenda of a 37 page presentation, then it's unlikely to give you any kind of return. Once you have the leadership commitment in place, the next question that a lot of people struggle with is, there are India has both the challenge and the opportunity that most banks will tell you they don't deal with tens of millions of customers, they deal with hundreds of millions of customers. So the first question that people have to tackle with is, who to sell, what to? The good news is, with all the advances in analytics, there is a lot of analytics that can be run in the background, so banks can be very, very targeted in having focused discussions with people who walk in, with customers that they outreach to. Once you identify the customers and what products are suitable for them, comes the second important building block, which is an end-to-end digitization block. It's very difficult to tell the customer that, look, you create a mind space, we will tell you which customer to have what conversation with, but then everything is paper-based. It just doesn't work, both on the selling side, but also on the servicing side. And last, but not the least, nothing really changes in our banks, as we all know, unless the behavior on the front line changes, both inside the branches and with relationship managers who spend a lot of time with the bank, with the customers. Most technology companies will tell you, we all hear about the quantum data that technology companies have, and that triggers a very different kind of debate. But most technology companies will tell you that they're really envious of banks. The quantity and quality of information that banks have on their customers is actually quite enviable. There are a large number of financial triggers that banks come to know. So, before your spouse finds out what is the bonus that you got, the bank will actually know the bonus amount that came into your account. If your income went up or if your income went down, banks are actually typically the first ones to find out. Also, if you made a material asset purchase that was funded by the bank will typically know. And even if you did not fully buy that asset from the bank, the bank still has enough information on what is really going on the asset side. These are the financial triggers. When you are booking a travel on any of the websites and you're using the bank's debit card or credit card, the bank's typically the first ones to know. When you change your nomination form, or you open your child's account, or you open a Sukanya Samriddhi account, the banks typically get to know a lot about what's going on in your life. And these can then form a very, very important trigger that tell you what conversation to have. So if a large bonus has come in, that's typically a very useful trigger for an asset management discussion to happen, because whether you like it or not, that customer will end up having a conversation with his family, his financial advisor, on what to do with the money that has come in. So banks can actually effectively use all the information that is available at their disposal to decide what products should be pitched to which customer. The second building block after analytics is, how do you create high quality end-to-end digitization? And what has happened over the last many years is, there is a lot of front-end work that has happened. So most banks, if you go and talk to them, will tell you that they have created a very elegant, very beautiful app. It's been given to every single relationship manager. But that's only the start. It doesn't really take away all the challenges that all the branch staff and all the relationship managers end up having to deal with. The first challenge is often a fulfillment challenge. To tell the bank that, look, we'll put all the information sort of at your fingertips in the app, but then you open the paper forms and start filling it, and by the way, the paper form starts with, tell me the customer's name, when the customer is standing in front of you and you know everything about the customer that you had to know, it is just a non-starter. So instant fulfillment, we live in the age of instant fulfillment. We are all used to figuring out, you know, where our cab is and where our pizza is. The expectations don't change when customers are dealing with banks and, you know, thinking about third-party products. So instant fulfillment can actually take away a lot of friction that is otherwise inherent in this journey. It is easier said than done, but it is a game changer when banks do it and do it well. On-demand information. If I have a set of questions, there is a key claim that's been filed. Rather than, you know, one of the banks that was filing it, we had visited the branch, and the typical journey, and it's not the exception, is the customer has walked into the branch, and the customer is asking, look, there is a accident in the family. I want to figure out which hospitals are covered. And the branch staff responds by saying, look at the number in front of my desk. Here's a call center number of the general insurance company or the health insurance company. Can you call the call center? You know, that's just a non-starter in today's world, where the customer expectations are that you will actually solve their challenge and solve their challenge in real time. So putting that information at the fingertips of the branch staff and the relationship managers can make a big difference. And last but not the least, if there's a question that you have on any of the products that's been sold, that information again has to seamlessly flow back into this app. So if you're sitting in front of the customer and the customer has a question on the NAV of the fund that you sold about what's going on, you cannot say, I will find out, or here's a contact center number. Very high quality tech integration using a chatbot or using a live chat can actually take some of that pain away. So we've talked about analytics, we've talked about end-to-end digitization. It doesn't really change anything unless the behavior on the ground changes. And over the last many years, the science of changing behaviors, has become quite well established. The power of habits was a New York bestseller, and it describes this three-step approach where if you are trying to change the behavior on the ground, then you have to start with a trigger. In this case, imagine the branch staff gets an SMS telling them that there are these three renewals that are coming up for renewal this week. Making it very easy for the specific individual to take action. Maybe it is sending a reminder and telling the customer. Maybe it is sending a link where the repayment can be, the renewal can be done instantaneously online. And when the action is completed, then ensuring that there is a automatic, almost real-time recognition for the action that the branch staff or the relationship manager has taken. Saying that you've done everything, and after 2 months of reconciliation, we will tell you that whether or not that policy got sold or the renewal happened or not is just a non-starter. And the last thing I'll share is that you need a committed leadership, but it needs more than motivation for the leadership. You need high quality visibility for leadership. Often the discussion that will happen at a zonal level or the discussion that will happen at a national level doesn't work if you are on the phone with the Delhi team and the Delhi team starts by saying our numbers and your numbers look very different. The power of digital is such that if you have everything happening on the digital platform, it can create very high quality visibility from end to end. Leaders can instantaneously find out how is the Delhi team doing and how is it doing vis-a-vis the Bombay team, and that can unlock a lot of value that sits inherent within the banks. We have a fantastic panel. We have lined up a set of senior bankers and senior technologists. So without further ado, let me get the panel discussion started. So we structured the entire discussion on the three dimensions that that I covered in the presentation. What are the opportunities? We'll get the panel's perspective on it. We'll then spend some time talking about challenges. And last but not the least, we want to hear the panelists' views on how are their organizations making it happen. So let me start with Mr. Khara. Sir, as many of us know, you were the CEO at SBI Mutual Fund before your elevation to the current role. So you have seen the story from both sides. And outside in, many of us can see, we saw the SBI number, many of us can see that SBI has clearly identified this is an important opportunity. Can you describe to us how does SBI see this opportunity, especially for products that are sitting outside the bank?
Thanks, Amit. Well, of course, I would say that the banking industry is quite something which is parallel to what the economy is. So if you go back in history, and you will probably observe that the way economy has evolved, it has all evolved around the debt. Raising borrowing from the banks and building up the capital in the country, that has been the model. Of late, we have started experiencing a situation where equity was quite a part of focus because the corporates are highly leveraged. That is something which is the macro scenario in which we are all operating. So I think partly it was on account of the fact that the banks were realizing the importance of the risk-weighted assets, and also there was a felt need in the banks for generating a revenue stream which was not involving any risk-weighted assets. That became a focus for the banks. Apart from that, when it comes to various companies also which are offering other, I mean, all financial products apart from banking, they had also matured. They had the advantage of having survived in that kind of a environment for a good number of years. They had built up some kind of a critical mass. But yes, of course, the tipping point was something which was very important. And to my mind, it was partly the experience of the companies, partly the felt need of the banks in terms of improving the revenue stream, which worked together. And also apart from that, in the intervening, as you all know that India is a data-rich country, but we had probably not leveraged that data fully in terms of exploring the various opportunities. Of late, that also came very handy, and we also could really visualize what the expectations of the customers are. And partly because customers also had evolved, and they are more pampered, they expect that there should be a doorstep delivery. So these are some of the contributing factors which led to a very positive atmosphere for offering all these products from the banking channel. But yes, of course, I would still say that when it comes to the non-banking product being rolled out from the banking channel, we have a huge potential to exploit. And I very often say that for a bank like State Bank of India, though we have grown significantly when it comes to our cross-selling income, but my belief is that it's an opportunity of not less than $1 billion kind of a revenue being generated through this kind of effort. And what needs to be done for that is very important. It's very often it so happens that the counter clerk who is there or the frontline executive who is there, he has got so many things on his head. But of late, with that advent of digitization and with the advent of a situation where many of the transactions are being done outside the branch channel, they have some time. But then we have to somehow see that we should pass on the information in such a manner which is intelligible by them, and they should internalize it well and should be in a position to communicate to the potential customer with a whole lot of conviction. Because unless and until there is a conviction on the part of our frontline marketer, no customer will buy the product. So I think to my mind that is very important, and for that we expect the companies to come forward in terms of providing information, because the frontline official know it for sure that if at all he sells a product, the servicing also is going to be his responsibility. So unless and until we equip him adequately for not only selling the product but also servicing going forward, I don't think we'll have a buy-in from such kind of employees. So I think these are some of the factors which goes a long way. And of course, the better customer experience through the help of digitization, there's the other piece which has helped the banks to really ramp up this kind of a revenue stream. Thank you.
Thank you, sir. Let me bring Mr. Rajiv Anand from Axis here. So Rajiv, you were also the CEO at Axis Mutual Fund. So you also have a very rich perspective here. How is Axis thinking about the cross-sell opportunity, both for banking products, but also for products, such as mutual fund, GI, LI?
So I think, first and foremost, if you think about the savings product, ultimately it's a transaction account. And while all of us are working very hard to ensure that savings balances in the accounts continue to grow, ultimately they only grow if you give the customer a hook, a need to use that account. And what data has shown us is that customers who have multiple products typically maintain better balances as compared to customers who have a single product. And I think if you look at it from the customer's perspective, as they go through the customer life cycle, they need investment products, mutual funds, they need protection products, life in general, They need loan products and of course what I call access products, meaning debit cards, credit cards, mobile banking, etc., to be able to simply and easily access money. And I think the job that that we as bankers look to do is to be able to sell at least one of these one or more of these products to customers. One, to be able to serve the needs of the customers at various points in his or her life, and also serve in ensuring that savings balances grow while we are doing this. So in a sense, to me, cross-sell serves two purposes. One is to get much deeper engagement with the customer, as also driving fee income, as Mr. Khara said, capital-free fee income, which is in a sense quite precious in the current day and age. The issue also is, do you sell your own products? Do you sell third-party products? I think to me, it is about selling what is right for the customer. If it means that Access Mutual Funds products are the best in class, they will obviously get sold. But if their funds are not doing well, or the products are not appropriate for the customer, we have an honest broker approach where we sell I think about 12 other mutual funds as well, to ensure that we're selling what is right for the customer. Similarly, we have relationships with third-party service providers on the insurance side to be able to sell what is right for the customer. The third aspect is how do you ensure that you are getting right selling in the branches? And I think this is where data comes into play. We know a fair amount, I think your presentation spoke about it as well, that we know a lot about what the customer is doing through transaction information. And we're really able to use this transaction information to be able to come up with the propensity to buy a particular product. So we feed that into our CRM at the front end, and in a sense gives our customer service officer or relationship manager a trigger to pitch a particular product at a particular point in time to customers. And over time, we have found that this approach has better take-up rates. The relationship manager is happier because the hit rates are better for him. The customer is happier because it looks like the bank knows where he or bank knows what product is critical to him, and so therefore the transaction becomes a lot more intuitive. And then of course, so there is propensity, there is next best product, etc. Are some of the instruments that we use to be able to write sell to customers. We also control the kind of products that we sell in a sense centrally. So we don't sell all mutual funds, we sell only some mutual funds. We ensure that we are risk profiling the customer. If the customer is buying a product outside his risk profile, there's an SMS trigger that goes in saying, hey, you're buying something outside your risk profile, you'll want to go through this transaction. On the insurance side, and unless the customer confirms that he has understood everything that he's buying, the transaction doesn't go through. And so therefore, there's a great deal of focus on pre-sales to ensure that that we're getting right sales through the branches. And I think what is critical also is we tend to believe that sort of the use of digital is that all transactions will go through on the mobile app or internet banking. But I think for a lot of the banking products, that physical touch is critical. And so therefore, the way that we look at it is that we use digital and data to enable the branches, enable the relationship manager to have much deeper and richer conversations with customers as well. So these are some of the things that that we do to ensure that that we're getting cross-selling going, not as something that we do on the side, but it's core to everything that we do, because ultimately cross-sell leads to better balances on savings accounts.
Thank you, Rajiv. Very helpful perspective. So let me bring Mr. Rajiv Ahuja from RBL into the discussion. Rajiv, you had I don't know whether I call it the luxury or the burden of restarting the bank when you and the current team, you know, came into, you know, Ratnakar and created a new bank. You know, was Crossell part of the thinking when the bank was being set up in its current avatar? You know, how has the approach changed, you know, since its founding days?
Thanks, Amit. I think every banker who spent 5-10 years in the industry, Crossell is a word which we kind of come to very quickly. And I echo everything which Mr. Khara and Rajiv have mentioned about the need for cross-sell and the manner in which to do so. So things around appropriateness, compliance for us were very critical. So when we set up our cross-sell business, getting the employees, getting the training, getting our right partners, and since we don't manufacture anything ourselves, you know, that made life a little simpler. And then doing 100% verification, for instance, in the insurance space, we actually have a inclination not to sell a few things because they just tend to get abused a lot. And again, we go through the same discipline of what's the risk profile, does the customer understand. And I think all of these things are very, very relevant because I think from a customer's perspective, you have to understand why is he or she coming to you. This is, again, you know, this has been, the banks have kind of created this market, enlarged the market over the last 20 odd years. There's a high degree of trust. There is a search cost which they dispense with. And hopefully with digitization, there's an onboarding, you know, and repeatability of documents which can be avoided. So many of these things are actually very important. I think banks have to now start thinking about, are they managing the full life cycle? So for instance, you know, why do customers still go to investment agents? Because when there is a problem, the investment agent or the insurance agent actually takes care of things. Whereas a banker, once the sale is done, you know, then tends to go to the next thing. I think, so how do you change that mindset and therefore means KRAs? I'll make one mention which has evolved in the last 12, 18 months that cross-sell actually was a push product by banks and has been historically so. It's worked so far well, but I think with information access, availability, analysis which is available openly, what's the value which you can contribute to the customer? What jobs of the customer are you able to do? You know, which for which the customer should give you his or her business. And I think that's a breaking point in my view. Especially for certain segments which can access this information and make their own analysis far more easily and perhaps are better at it than the bank's own employees. And I think there you have to be careful that your traditional supply chain of employee training, compliance, understanding, access to customers just because they have a savings account can start breaking down. And you've already seen that happen in many other products. So think about securities broking, which, you know, is a little different from what we're discussing. I mean, today you have many standalone securities broking companies because the information and analysis part has been severed or unbundled from the entire product stack. I'm sure when the mic goes to Adhil, he will talk about how he's making access to information and transactions more democratic. Also, it imposes a lot of pressure on, you know, fees, and I saw you putting the fees down. I think this is a recipe for somebody to say, your fees is my opportunity. Because if you cannot continue adding value, and that vector of value will keep shifting, if you cannot continue doing that, then I don't think banks can justifiably stand up and say, I have your savings account, please do your investments and insurance with me. Because that, for certain segments, may not work. And I think you're seeing changes from the regulator, both SEBI, Birla, putting a lot of pressure on intermediary commissions, trade commissions, recognition of the same, churning. How do these things play in your own approach to the market, your go-to market? It could cause many changes on the margin. And I think we should not live in a comfort zone or complacency that because we are banks and because we have the client savings account, these things should naturally come to us. It may come to us by default because the guy uses your account, but actually the primary relationship could be with a bank bazaar equivalent or something in that same space. So I think our thinking in the last 18 months has changed. And we think actually the way the industry economic curve and the customer expectation curve is evolving, in certain segments this will change. So you have segments which will be HNIs, which will require a huge high touch, and where you'll probably be accepting an overall advisory fee rather than a per transaction fee. And then you'll have open market where you're actually acquiring customers digitally, where this will be a bundled offering, and where then you'll be able to sacrifice your intermediary commission. So I think some of these changes are emerging, and we just need to be cognizant that until and unless we can continue creating different vectors of value or solving the customer's problem, I think our rationale of sitting here and saying these things naturally come to us, even if we do the right things, can be challenged.
Thank you, Rajeev. So Adhil, let me bring you in. Bank Bazaars, sort of built a very high quality platform, and so you end up working with most of the large financial institutions. So you have a very unique vantage point. How do you see the opportunity? And also it would be useful to get for all of us a perspective on, is every financial institution seeing it similarly, or are there differences?
Thanks, Amit. So Bank Bazaar collaborates closely with most of the leading bankers and banks on this panel. We focus on digital acquisition, both on the cross-sell part and the new customer part. I want to call out three trends that we are seeing in the market as we speak. One is a tsunami of young consumers coming online expecting products digitally. So growth rates on an annualized basis have been about 100%. So even at top of the funnel, from about 17 million visitors a month a year ago, Bank Bazaar is talking about 35 million visitors a month right now. What we find is these consumers expect a personalized service. So the expectation coming onto the platform is very high, and they're willing to engage deeply. So like Rajiv pointed out, I think the consumer is savvy enough that we're seeing up to 60% of them say, tell me what you want. You want me to upload documents? You want me to authorize my KYC? I'm willing to do that, up to 60%. But in return, right, give me that instantaneous service which you emphasized earlier. A lot of innovative work is happening in the banking industry around pre-approved programs, for example, around one-click checkout on loans and credit cards. So around personalization, I think digital offers a great platform to build on. Lastly, what we see is that this is a direct to consumer channel without any intermediary. And the feedback we've been getting is in terms of long-term portfolio performance, be it in terms of activation rates on the card program, in terms of non-performing assets, given that everything like the documents is from source, given that there's no intermediary, quality is playing out to be much higher. When you ask me the question about our banks, or which banks are doing well, which banks are not, I think, interestingly, my view of the data is the following. We're seeing a clear dichotomy between cross-sell to existing customers and new customer acquisition on the internet. I think there's been tremendous amount of progress in terms of cross-selling on the mobile app and being able to deliver credit cards, being able to deliver loans to customers who are part of the existing base. I think where the opportunity for collaboration really comes in is in new customer acquisition. Now, new customer acquisition tends to be very expensive. It tends to be very expensive because media is sold per click or per banner. It tends to be expensive because we're dependent on a supply chain which, if done physically, has multiple friction points. So what we see as a clear direction is, one, collaboration in terms of new customer acquisition. Can we convert the CapEx model more into a partnership OpEx model? And secondly, can we work on a paperless supply chain so that the physical friction points are broken off, and instantaneously, without paper, in 5 minutes, we're able to distribute a financial product? So that's the view and the data that we're seeing in the market.
Thank you, Adhil. So we got the panel's take on the opportunities that this presents. There are clearly challenges. Sudhakar, let me bring you in on the challenges front. The current model was without any challenges, and we probably wouldn't have seen new forms of bank, including yours. Your bank, even more than RBL, really started without any legacy and the constraints that come along with it. And you've also been focused on the underserved segment, or one of the focus areas in the underserved segment. How do you see this opportunity, and more importantly, what are the challenges here?
Yeah, my first challenge is all the people on this side are happy to say this is cross-sell. because they have a big banking income on one side, so they can say this as cross-sell. I don't have that. For me, this is all sell. So this is all we do. And hence, the way we structure the bank has to be appropriate. Yes, we have the advantage of starting afresh. So we see banking as a platform. Internally, we don't use the word cross-sell. We see banking as a platform where customer comes and does the basic banking transactions. The amount of money that he does with us is far less. But everything else that we do for the customer goes through our platform. And it doesn't matter whether we work with underserved or less served set of customers. What they see and what they need is many of the issues that we spoke about, right? People don't want to see paper. They want to see instant closures. They want to have a seamless experience. Most of them would like to get assistance for this seamless experience. And that is what we have been trying to build. So we have a platform. We have multiple partners with whom we work with. And all these partners do not bring in their front ends into our system. The experience to the customer is seamless through our front end, whether it is through the digital channel or whether it is through the assisted channel that we have. And we work with a whole lot of intermediaries through whom we go and engage in banking and non-banking activities with our customers. So there is no paper in the process. We work with people to develop a process with them where paper is removed. So I don't see paper, we are completely paperless in our banking, except when it comes to some of the loan products where we need to necessarily go through paper. And what it helps is that for that person in the front, it makes it easier for him to shift from one screen to the other. The product process is almost similar. It is about explaining the product, it is about the details of the customer, like you said in your presentation. We don't get there at all because the person comes in as a customer first. So all the details of the customer are already there with us. It's only about the product and what the customer wants to do. So by reducing the time involved in the process of selling, by reducing the time involved in actually discussing the process of doing the transaction, we actually benefit the customer substantially. We've been able to put it together because we just started afresh. I know it is a little tricky to do in an existing setup, but in the way we are trying to do, we've got about 20-30 partners already. But everybody has been working together in this. We've been able to construct few innovative products. How do you bundle a set of products? And in a cross-sell context, product bundling is an essential thing. If you're able to put together 2-3 products that make sense for the customer and reduce the transaction friction, it works much better. And then servicing again. So servicing again is very critical. If you make the person go back to paper for servicing, again it's going to be trouble for him as well as for the person who's servicing. So what we've done is we've moved the entire bank and all the products to his mobile. All he needs to know is his mobile number and he'll get service. So how do you keep it simple? How do you make it much more easier, particularly for those in tier 3, tier 4 towns and villages? They are equally savvy. I will not call them not savvy. They are equally savvy. You know, India has a lot of people who are still illiterate, I presume, but illiterate is when it comes to the alphabets and the languages, not when it comes to maths. Almost everybody understands maths. Even if whether the person has gone to a school or not, he understands maths, or he or she understands maths very well. So we are in a banking industry, we deal with those savvy customers only. So how do we provide the right set of products for them at that point in time when they come into our intermediary locations? Is what we've been working on. Initial success have been reasonably good. Let's hope it works.
Thank you, Sudhakar. Shinjini, you have played multiple roles before taking away your current role in Citi. It gives you very unique perspectives. What are some of the challenges as you see them, in capturing opportunities that otherwise, on the surface seem very easy?
So, there are there are advantages to coming after many good speakers. I don't really need to repeat much about cross-sell or or what it really means. So let me just start out by saying that fundamentally retail banks have to deal with this question of whether they are going to be reduced to a utility or whether they are going to be able to build relationships with their customers that makes them meaningful, right? So I like binaries. So there are two positions. You either become a utility where the customer first decides what they want to do with their money, and then they use your bank account to do that. And to come to that decision, they could be using multiple channels. That's not material. But as far as you are concerned, the customer comes to you after the decision has been made and uses you as a utility. The second scenario, which presumably we as banks will like, is where the bank considers us to be a relationship. Now, what is a relationship? And I've really given it a lot of thought because I realize a relationship is significant when given the choice, you will still continue with the same partner, right? Even if it is painful sometimes, okay? So what happens is that, so for example, I have a place where I've been going for my health checkups for the last, whatever, 10 years. Now, when I joined Citi doesn't reimburse expenses for this particular place. So I had a choice of going to a new place or continuing with the same place. And after much thought, I decided to continue with the same place because the friction in carrying those 10-year-old records to a new place and to explain to a new set of doctors is just too much. You don't want to do that, and therefore you continue. That's a relationship. On the other hand, I just changed my service provider for airline ticketing. Somebody had used for 5 years, so they had enough data, and I liked them. But I chose another interface because that interface became better. And I was able to switch quickly because the switching was very, very easy because I could easily build the data that I had with the previous service provider, and travel data is not so painful even if I don't have old travel data. So for banking, that's the situation which faces you on an everyday basis. And therefore, the challenge is that to prevent yourself from being reduced to a utility, you would like to build relationships. Your subject today is in the age of hyper-personalization, right? Now, hyper-personalization is one way for you to, so there used to be a card in those days in our times, which used to say, don't ever leave me, you know too much about me, right? So hyper-personalization is that, right? It's important to a relationship because I know so much about you and you know so much about me that leaving each other is a little bit of a friction. So it's very important for us to be able to get our arms around what the customer does, what he needs, etc. And there's only one way to do it, which has already been demonstrated by people that have been leaders in the digital ecosystem, which is to start thinking of everything from the customer's perspective, right? Now, the customer's perspective is very simple. The customer either knows what he wants to do or he's trying to figure out. And the customer either trusts you or the customer does not trust you. And there are combinations of those two factors, right? So the customer can know what he wants to do and trust you enough, in which case it's the best happy flow. He comes, you tell him what to do, he just goes ahead and does it. The customer knows what he wants to do, doesn't trust you, is also not so bad because he treats you like a utility, he comes and he finishes his transaction. But the customer doesn't know and doesn't trust you is a very painful situation. But the customer doesn't know and the customer knows and doesn't trust you is a very difficult situation as well. So you need to be prepared to deal with all those situations and to be able to give the customer the reassurance that I know why this works for you, or I know why something else does not work for you. I know that you think that you have made a choice, but would you like to consider three more facts before you take an action on your those are the meaningful conversations. Those are conversations that lead to relationship building. Those are conversations that lead to higher tenure trust, all of which people have spoken about. But to the question that you asked me is what constitutes a challenge to move to this place, right? Because it's not difficult. We are not doing rocket science. We are not building the spaceship to take us to the Mars or discover life there. So it's very simple. And we are all building relationships on a daily basis in our lives. Digital companies are building these relationships. I'm quite sure that my digital service providers like Amazon or Book My Show know a lot about me, right? They know where I live, they know where to deliver my things. They don't ask me every time, right? They know my tastes and preferences. They are able to give me good offers, etc. Why is it that banking finds it so difficult? And that's where the challenges are, right? And the challenges are primarily because in the banking regulatory architecture, and this is not specific to India, this is globally, it is banks are expected to be more gatekeepers than enablers. So it's very fundamentally different from what digital ecosystem providers are expected to be. So your job is to say, this person, before he becomes my client, already has to prove by their credentials that they are the right people, they're not money launderers, they're not terrorists, they're not this, they're not that. So to prove all of that, your entry points are full of friction. Entry points are full of friction for you, but even after you have made your customer jump through hoops to prove those credentials to you, and now you have a relationship, and now you know that, you know, you're not perfect, you may have a little flaw, but you're good, you work. But even then, to take that relationship one notch further and to introduce you to my friend, I still need to put you through the same level of interview. That is too much friction. That friction is fundamentally responsible for the fact that banks are not having the data, having the relationship, having the ability to build on that, they're not able to take the same step forward, right? Now, of course, the argument is that banking is sensitive, you're taking care of people's money, and therefore you need to, so there could be multiple arguments, but fundamentally, I think that's a very big challenge when it comes to introducing, and I don't like to call it cross-sell, because selling definitely implies that I am selling something on behalf of somebody, but the reality is that if you do it the right way, which is what almost everyone on the panel reflected, is effectively you are fulfilling a need that your customer has, and you are the best positioned to fulfill that need because of your understanding or your infrastructure or your relationships. But how do you move ahead does have friction at this point.
Thank you, Shinjini. So we heard the panel on the opportunities that is present and some of the challenges. Let's now shift gears and get into the last part of the panel discussion, which is making it happen. Let me start with two technologists that we have on the panel. So Arijit, let's start with you. Technology is clearly critical. Some of the friction points that Shinjini is talking about have a regulatory side to it, but technology can help alleviate some of the other challenges. Just given your role, how would you describe the readiness of financial institutions? What are some of the challenges that they have to tackle with the help of technology?
Thank you, Amit, and good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen. I think it all starts with data, and let me just spend some time in outlining what we think how the future data strategy of financial institutions should look like. Today, I think all the financial institutions are really thinking about how do we handle so much of data and what do we do with it finally, right? The good news is all the external data which is available today forms only 20% of all the data in the world. 80% of the data today lies within your own enterprise. So that's the gold mine, be it your underwriting information, decades of underwriting information, be it your customer experience, your risky loans, whatever. So that data is within the enterprise. So that's the good news for all the financial institutions, that your source of competitive advantage is within your enterprise. But at the same time, if you really look at the way the world is progressing with the advent of technology, data and information is almost becoming everywhere, right? And it is getting more and more shared within organizations, driven primarily by demographic forces and some of it by even regulatory forces. So in this situation, I think what we are seeing the banks, all the other financial institutions are faced with challenges is, it's not only good enough to get insights of the data, it's about how do you create differentiated insights. Because end of the day, the customer is same. The insight, the data may be same, but it's about how you get differentiated insights. And getting the differentiated insights once is not enough. It is important to have a framework that will help you get the differentiated insights in a sustainable manner for the future, right? So a couple of things. So it all starts with the kind of data governance framework which banks should have. It's important that the data should be available at the right time, at the right place. That will really make your interactions with your customers more real-time, more contextual, and going back to the point, more hyper-relevant. Just personalization, I think a lot of banks have been doing it for over the last couple of years. It's really not enough. Having said that, it is really important that you have a strong data governance framework, which is not restrictive. Today, most of the banks look at data governance framework as a restrictive way of analytic compliance. They should encourage to make it more democratic and look at the data governance framework to use it and make it available to everyone in the organization to give the incremental insights and overall insight to an organization. That's one. To support the right data governance framework, I think financial institutions should look at a very, very strong and robust data platform. You need to have a platform that will be able to serve you the right data in a curated fashion and be data of any form and be data coming from any source, be it structured, unstructured. So having a right and robust data platform is very, very important. Now, what do you do with all this data? And that is why at the central of this revolution, I think the entire subject of artificial intelligence is going to take center stage. Now, artificial intelligence or the AI architecture of a firm could be very different. Some people call it machine learning, which is about, you know, looking at vast amounts of data, creating predictive models, identifying patterns, or it could be cognitive systems, which are about learning, understanding, and interacting with us in a form of natural language. Or going back to the point one of the panelists said, we believe it is not going to be artificial intelligence as we go ahead, it is going to be augmented intelligence. AI today, or AI even for the next couple of decades, may not really be advanced to drive decisions like what humans do. It has to be augmented intelligence where it has to be not man versus machine, it has to be man and machine. You can feed in any amount of logic to an AI machine. You can fill in any amount of moral, but when it comes to ethics, you will still require human intervention. So I think whether it's cross-sell, upsell, or whether it is getting most out of your data, you need to have an AI architecture which supports that, and at the end of the day, augment it with the right human skills so that you are able to make the best use of it. The fourth important thing, which is very important today, and going back to what I said in terms of having a sustainable, differentiated insights, is the entire issue of data privacy. Right? Today, there is a gap between consumer trust and data privacy. Right? There is a lot of anxiousness among consumers today in terms of what is happening to the data. I'm anxious about what happens to my data. I'm sure all of you are anxious to what is happening to your data. So I think the important thing would be how organizations are really able to handle the personal information over its entire life cycle and ensuring there is a delicate balance between the hyper-personalization, hyper-relevance, or whatever you may want to call, along with the privacy. So data privacy is going to be very important. There was a survey done recently and 80% of the respondents said that however good the products of a bank or a financial institution may be, unless I really trust that organization with my data, I will not do business. So for you to get incremental insights on a daily basis, on a monthly basis, yearly basis, or in the future of your customer, you need him to share more and more data with you. So building that trust is very important, because if the trust is broken once, he's not going to come back and do business with you. So data privacy would be the final thing which most of the banks and the financial institutions today are challenged with, and they need to have a really, really strong practice around it.
Thank you, Arjun. Abhay, let me bring you in. You know, your group's been serving the sector for many decades. Can you describe how can technology be used to overcome some of the challenges that you know, we are discussing on the panel?
Thank you, Amit. We've been engaged with the banking sector for now over seven decades. And we've seen a very interesting change from paper-based cross-selling to now digital technology. So if we go back, the paper-based cross-selling had one intrinsic problem, that the seller needed to know all the products that you were selling and needed to have the knowledge about that. That was a major challenge, because everybody can't be an expert in everything. Over the technology brought in several instruments, several devices, which basically aggregated the knowledge from different individuals. You have the automated kiosk, which are self-service, or a tablet, or a device. Or internet banking, wherein the consumer could pull information and was able to self-service, or a bot or a call center or RPA could provide an automated service to cross-sell a product. But with that, now there are two major challenges that we started selling, that the cross-selling was not personalized, And as Ajit said, you know, the data plays a crucial role, that whether the bank should start, your own bank should continue selling you the same saving account or something else, right? So the data played a crucial role, and that is very, very important in personalization. Today, personalization of cross-selling rarely happens. But the second part is, now, do I really want to self-service myself and expose what my needs are through the internet and then get spammed with multiple service provider because the search engine found me looking for a mutual fund or a saving bank or time deposit or what have you, and then get spammed for that. So that also brought in a challenge from point of view of technology platform, that people's trust in data or access becomes an important part. Now when we look at the rural part of the country, that's again a very interesting part where you sell, where you can cross-sell. Now, the important part or important challenges are obviously the network, electricity, distance, and the literacy. Not just literacy, the digital and the other one. The other important part is in these areas that somebody has gone and sold something wrong or something not the most appropriate for the consumer, and that has created a trust factor which directly impacts, while the technology is available, technology provides the platform, his ability to believe or her ability to believe and buy that. Often these are reference sold. References plays an important role for cross-selling these products, and that's a crucial part about information and knowledge. But now with the technology, that can be addressed through the appropriate means and learning. A literacy, a digital literacy is very important, as well as about the banking products. So many a times you see an insurance being sold instead of a time deposit or vice versa. And that becomes a challenge in the rural part. The other part, the distance, now can be an important thing wherein aggregators can bring multiple solutions together so that the banks or financial institutions don't need to provide specific efforts or specific individuals to cross-sell. And their technology will definitely play an important role to reduce the distances, reduce the cost, even taking it to the remote parts and creating an offline transactions. I think there is a lot of opportunities which technology can bring, Amit, compared to the challenges that you see.
Thank you, Abhay. So let me now bring the bankers on the panel on their take on what does it take to capitalize on the opportunities. Let me start with you, Mr. Khara. There are many public sector banks that believe cross-sell or all-sell is just not possible with all the constraints that they end up having to deal with. SBI has just, we saw the numbers, has just shown that is simply not true. What can banks learn from SBI, and how critical, in your experience, the leadership support?
I think first and foremost, what is required to be understood and appreciated at the bank's level is that it is not actually cross-sell, it is a customer value enhancement proposition. And the kind of competition which they are all facing, unless and until they have built up a stickiness, they will not be in a position to retain those customers, considering the kind of competition which is coming not only from banks but also from non-bank institutions. I think that's a reality which people need to realize. I think very critical component would be for the banks to ensure that they build up their knowledge and skill piece as far as their frontline staff is concerned. And for that, the frontline is all very well equipped to market the coupon product. And likewise, even the larger component of the customers also, larger chunk of customers who are walking into the bank's branches, also they are also looking for something akin to which is coupon product. So, one, of course, the customer's expectation has to be rationalized. There need to be a sharing of knowledge with the customers. They are very much aware of what all is available in the market, but somehow their confidence is not as strong about the product. One, of course, the brand from where it is getting marketed, that matters. But eventually, the fairness of the opinion which is given by the frontline staff, that holds a very critical piece in building up the relationship, in building up the confidence of the customers in such product. Otherwise, I think in terms of market, it's a huge market. I very often say that public sector banks, considering their reach in the upcountry locations, and I think banking sector in general, they are the best place in terms of reaching out such product to the much wider population. That's one of the reasons why when you look at the penetration level, when it comes to mutual fund, it is just about 11%. When it comes to insurance, it is even lesser. There is enough safeguards which are now being built into the system in terms of compliances, in terms of ensuring that there is a right selling, there is no mis-selling. And even for that matter, banks are also very mindful because they cannot probably put their brand at this stake for the kind of fee income which they are earning. So I think the processes are being built up, the processes need to be strengthened. There is a need for generating adequate knowledge on ground, which will probably help in building up this kind of franchise.
Thank you, Mr. Khara. Very, very helpful perspective. Let me turn to Mr. Rajeev Ahuja. RBL has been quite an active advocate of partnerships. You know, we see on the standy there, Partners Ka Bank. It's been an active advocate of open banking. You know, can you describe the journey of RBL towards achieving much higher levels of cross-sell, leveraging what partners can bring to the table?
Thanks. So our approach towards partnership or open banking is one aspect of trying to do away with having 20 years less legacy or history, SBI maybe more. And the one view we have is customers are bundling and unbundling themselves in various segments. And it's always not possible to be the primary driver of the relationship. So through our partnerships across many spectrums, cards, payments, B2B, B2C, we've been experimenting with leveraging the client engagement, the data. Obviously, one has to be very careful about commission here, to be able to figure out what other avenues of services we can provide to these customers. So I can say that a lot of interesting work around insurance, and actually in some cases we're able to cross-sell even our savings account, credit cards, and now we are thinking about investments. We don't need to be actually the primary account holder. We can use investments as the driving product. So, but very important to understand that every partnership does not give you the license to do it. The customers really care about that one particular service, so you need to be respectful of that. However, you can test and learn, and then see how you can leverage data with partners to be able to create more services for the partners to get better embedded into the customer's life cycle and therefore benefit you. So that's been our overarching philosophy.
Thank you, Rajiv. Very helpful perspective. Let me bring Mr. Rajiv Anand. Outside in, Rajiv, it seems that Access has been pushed quite consistently on the digitization front, in earlier part of the conversation, is quite a critical factor. Can you describe the Access story here? How important is the end-to-end digitization for success here?
We took this journey about maybe 5-6 years ago. The first phase was about moving some of the processes out to the branch and centralizing them. The second phase was going through a lean management structure. The third was trying to see how we can go end-to-end digital or digitized, as the case may be. And it also gave us the opportunity to relook at multiple processes. Many of the hoops that Shinjini spoke about, we found that many of these hoops were created for customers where, in a sense, contextual, something had happened 5-7 years ago, and we put up two more layers of security, and therefore it became that much more difficult for the customer to transact or open an account or whatever it is. Digitization gave us the opportunity to relook at some of these. And I think the beauty of technology is really that we've been able to get that balance between operational risk on one side and customer experience on the other, and getting that balance right has been something that has happened only because of the use of technology. Just to give you an example, we open accounts now digitally on tablets, etc. So account opening is pretty much instant thanks to the use of our app and things like that. and many of us remember it used to take anything between 7 to 10 days, you know, before you could open an account. And I think that that sort of change in terms of TATs has fundamentally happened only because of the use of technology. Similarly, data now helps us make offers to customers, you know, for loans, for credit cards, and so therefore the ability to get a credit card or get a loan product from us for pre-approved customers is pretty much instantaneous, and that we are able to manage credit and operational risk on one side and be able to provide this sort of customer experience is because of the fact that we've been able to digitize end to end and at the same time be able to use data to provide a differentiated customer experience.
Thank you, Rajeev. You know, finding that balance on the two sides, quite an important point. Sudhakar, what would just given how you look at this opportunity, and it's not cross sell, it's all sell. What would success look like in a few years? What are some of the things that you're doing to make it happen?
Success for us is, I guess, pretty much in terms of how others will look at it. If I have a set of customers, and we are still in pilot, so we're testing out with many of these concepts and seeing green shoots of success somewhere. But success really for us is, like Shinjini said, it is relationship banking, but of a very different magnitude. I don't have the necessary resources to be able to provide red carpet relationship banking to the people in a village or a town. But the way we are trying to work it out is that we should be able to get into a location where typically most of the locations we go into are underserved. How do we provide an ecosystem where a person who today uses cash is able to use a bank as a means for payment, be it through a smartphone, be it through a regular phone, non-smartphone, or through an assisted channel. That is really what we are trying to do. So for us, when we say digital, in the context of what we are saying here, for us, digital is when we convert a person from using cash to a bank account as a means for his transaction. If, and we know that an individual or a family does about 80 to 90 transactions a month, which is a money transaction. So how can we move forward over the next few years to a location that we go to, we get to see a sizable portion of that population being able to transact digitally for, let's say, 30 to 40%, 40 to 50% of their regular monthly needs. That is really our interest. And if we're able to do that, then we capture the imagination of that population. We should be able to provide them the opportunity. If they go to a banking point of ours, they should be able to do transactions, obviously, without using any cash. If they go to a merchant nearby in that village, they should be able to pay for their services without having to use cash. So if you can do that, then automatically the rest of the products will also happen through us. That is really the intent that we have. I think the journey has started well. We are seeing green shoots in terms of success in some of these scenarios. People are quite receptive. What they need is a very, very strong friction-free solution. Because most people want to go, and this we have heard in digital stories as well, right? People don't want to go and spend money. They want to go buy a product. Somebody is interested in buying a book, somebody is interested in buying a mobile, somebody is interested in buying a shirt. But sometimes what happens is, it takes far less time to choose the product that they want to buy. And it takes much longer to make the payment. If the journey on payment is that much longer, then that is the friction that we want to avoid. So how do we create, use the technology to create a process that will help reduce this friction? See, if you can open a bank account in 3 to 5 minutes, that's good. Like Rajiv said, it used to take much longer to open these accounts in the past. It takes now 3 to 5 minutes to open a bank account, full-fledged bank account with biometric KYC. And that's what people want. If I can sell an insurance product in 3 to 5 minutes, that's really what they want. So obviously what it means is that we will not be able to have the bells and whistles. But a basic insurance product should be able to sell in 3 to 5 minutes. You know, most of this country don't have a two-wheeler insurance. How much time should it take to go and buy a two-wheeler insurance? All you need is the number of the vehicle, if possible the engine and the chassis number, and you should be able to provide the insurance, the pricing are all the same. So how do we create these products? How do we use data in the back end to understand that this person has a two-wheeler and to reach out to him and help him buy the two-wheeler insurance in 2 or 3 clicks? That is really what we are trying to do. And if you're able to capture their imagination and get 8 to 10 transactions per customer per month of the wholesale model, I think then you're good.
Thanks, Sudhakar. Shinjini, is cross-sell a big part of your mandate at Citi? And, you know, just also, you know, you are the only panel member who works for a foreign-owned bank. You know, are there places where you are able to take advantage of what Citi has to offer globally?
So I'll answer your questions, but I have to share a story before that with the audience, because what Sudhakar was talking reminded me of something which when I was at PGM, one of the things we did was we went to villages to understand how people do financial transactions, and everybody, I sent my entire team out and I went to a village myself. And I met a person, so it was evening, and I wanted to see how the milk collection centers work. So I went to a place where people came to give milk in the evening. And so there was this young man who came to give milk, and he had about 10 kilos of milk with him. And I started talking to him, and I said, you know, how do you get paid and what do you do, etc. And I asked him at one point that, and I assume everybody knows Hindi, and I said, agar aapko koi ek cheez chahiye थी तो आपको क्या चीज़ आपको चाहिए आज? तो he said मुझे अपनी गाय के लिए इंश्योरेंस चाहिए. And I was really struck by that. So I said, अगर आपको पता है कि आपको अपनी गाय के लिए इंश्योरेंस, so I said why? तो he said मेरी एक गाय बीमार हो गई है, तो मैं रोज 20 किलो दूध आता था, पर आज मैं 10 किलो लाया क्योंकि मेरी दूसरी गाय बीमार है, समथिंग लाइक दैट, ऑडियल ट्री काउज या समथिंग लाइक दैट. And he said, अगर उसको कुछ हो गया तो मैं कल से क्या करूँगा? So इसलिए मुझे अगर इंश्योरेंस होता तो अच्छा होता. तो I said, अगर आपको पता है कि इंश्योरेंस इज गुड फॉर यू, why don't you go and get it? Right? You know, the guy wanted an insurance, so I said, if you know, why don't you go and get it? So he said, because I have these cows to take care of, and the insurance is, and the place is far, and I, you know, the usual story, so I can't get it. So I guess there is really a big market out there. So okay, now to your questions of Citi. You know, my mandate in equal measure is revenue, client experience, and compliance. Okay, so cross-sell is one way to my revenue. It has to be completely driven by my client experience and the client need. We are a significant wealth franchise, so without a shade of doubt, we want our customers to be able to invest their money in the right products, to be able to have the right level of insurance for them and their families, and to be able to buy general insurance. So the product suite is in place, some of it is building up. But the way we look at it is, we look at our clients in different segments, right? So the wealth and the... So we have a large segment of population that is primarily salaried customer. The average age of this segment is about 32 years. 85% of them access us on their internet or mobile at least 5 times in a month, which is, I think, phenomenal digital metric. And what we found, so, and to your question of how we are looking at it, is we started looking at some of this data. Because when I came, I got very excited about this digital metric, and I said, let's look at more of what this population segment is doing. And what we realized is that these are salaried customers, so they get their salaries, but they pretty much spend most of their salaries by the end of their month, or by the end of the month. And when we started getting into the data, we realized that they were making investments, but they were not making it through us, right? So then we said, this is a digital population, and they like to do investments, but they will like to do it in the way they like to do it. So then we said, okay, how do we build this? So that's how we approach it. So we approach it more in terms of, to your question of global, yes, definitely. The good thing is that in like most multinational organizations, our priorities are aligned to what we do globally. And in terms of both technology enhancement as well as the client value proposition, we do work very closely. One of the things that is very exciting for me is how we are globally looking at using more augmented intelligence to put together the relationship manager and the client in their journey of relationship and management, as well as making their investments or taking care of their wealth. So those are some of the very interesting things that are currently underway, and we definitely benefit a lot from global experiences and experiments.
Thank you, Shinjini. So I have some more questions for Adhil, Abhay and Arijit, but I'm also conscious of time, and I want to give the audience the opportunity to ask questions to the panel as well. So why don't we open the floor and get any questions that you may have for the panel, and if I'm permitted some time, then I'll ask some more questions in the end. Can we get a mic right in the middle? Please state your name and the organization that you work for, and if the question is directed at a specific panel member, just mention that as well.
Hello. My name is Ozil. I work for FIBAC and I lead the analytics team. So when we look at the bureau data, we see a particular pattern of taking products. So let's say it's a two-wheeler, and then a PL, and then maybe a house. What we also observe is that ticket sizes also change from segment to segment, and also the timing of the next product. So when you're talking about cross-sell, so let's say it's the same base of the different one, do you factor in these elements from a cross-sell standpoint? So the timing to the next product, the ticket size that you're going for, and also the product category, specific targeted elements.
Thank you.
Yeah, I think these are the kind of informations which are certainly looked into with a whole lot of interest. It's more of a predictive behavior which is being attempted. Some of the companies which we have, they have already started doing it. Of course, your example is essentially in the context of general insurance. But I can certainly say that in case of our card company, we are almost instantaneously reaching out to the customers when we see that they have done some high value purchase. So that's the kind of analytics which are being run on the data set on an ongoing basis. That's, I think, is a reality, and practically it's happening in all the companies. Going forward, probably it will go up even more with the increasing use of analytics on the data.
Thank you, Mr. Khara. Any of the other panelists add to the point that Mr. Khara made? Rajiv?
I think the next challenge really is to be able to get to the customer when he wants it, where he wants it, is really the challenge. I think the point that you're making is very valid, that the customer is not looking for a car loan or a housing loan, he's looking for a car or a house to start with. And so therefore, how do you, as a financial institution, for this customer who is in a sense pre-approved with you, how do you get into that that journey while he's looking for a car, or he's looking on the internet to figure out which is the best car to buy, or as he's thinking about a home, how do you get into that customer journey well before he actually sort of decides that, yes, I've decided to buy this house and now I want a loan. I think banks are now looking to see how we can engage. Just to give you another example is, I'm standing in Croma, I'm looking at this nice big TV which I want to buy, maybe I'm 20,000 rupees short, maybe I'm 50,000 rupees short. How can I be able to sort of contextualize that for you to say, hey, go ahead and buy that TV, here is a credit that is available to you at the checkout, to be able to fulfill your desire or dream at that point in time. I think that's really the next phase of credit delivery, particularly for retail investors that you're going to see.
Thank you, Rajiv. Any other questions from the audience? If you have a question, just keep it ready, and let me just get to the last set of questions I wanted to ask. So Adhil, anything else? We've heard all the panelists describe how they're thinking about the opportunities, what does it take to make it happen, Anything else that banks can take advantage of given everything that's available?
So I'd like to suggest a framework in which we look at digital growth as along two axes. So one is cross-sell, and we spoke about it in great detail, where we're selling to our own customers, and I think that's something the banks have really raised. The other axis is new customer acquisition on the digital front. I think both opportunities have similarities and they have differences. I'll talk about the differences then the similarities. The differences on the cross-sell side, it's relatively inexpensive because we have the customer on the mobile app, we have the customer on the site, but there is a certain bound to which it can grow. On the new customer side, it tends to be boundless because we have an entire generation which is sweeping onto the internet, sweeping onto mobile apps in order to consume products. However, acquisition tends to be expensive because now we're acquiring on a per-click basis without knowing if the person is going to buy or not. Now, interestingly, right, there are three trends we're seeing at BankBazaar in collaboration with our partners, which are tackling this new customer acquisition story. So the first is paperless and presenceless. We spoke about it in great detail. The second is personalized. I think these people are saying that I bought with you before. Can you offer me a one-click checkout? Can you offer me a pre-approved offer? So I believe the way this is going to work out is collaborative. It is an opportunity wherein multiple parties can come together in order to deliver that experience that the millennial wants. So I'd end with that. I believe it's going to be paperless. I believe it's going to be collaborative, and I believe it's going to be personalized.
Thank you, Adhil. Any questions from the audience? Otherwise, I'll go on to the remaining two questions I have. Okay. Abhay, what is your take? Given all the investments that you are making, in technology, are there specific areas that you wish that banks will take more advantage of, and banks haven't quite figured it out?
Thank you, Amit. So on we clearly are seeing that the area of knowledge enablement and bringing that information to front end is an area where banks are playing a significant role, and empowering the customer sales or even the consumer directly in their hands. I think the other important part is the authentication, identification, as well as onboarding of clients is getting outsourced by this bank. Now this is where cross-selling plays an important part, and empowering those service providers to cross-sell and create a wide service platform is a very, very important thing. Of course, there is a next element of collaboration on non-competing services across two different organizations or four different organizations, which the technology could enable and provide that service to the end consumer as well as to the bank in improving the stickiness. I think that's a next point of view that we'll have.
Thank you, Abhay. Last question that I had is for you, Arijit. You mentioned AI. I was with a friend who is starting his company, and he's looking at various opportunities, and one of the opportunities he's looking at is AI ML for financial institutions. And I was asking him, what's the difference, how do you look at it? And he had a funny line to describe it, which is, when you're raising funds, you call it AI. When you're recruiting, you call it ML, and when you do it, it's statistics. So there's a lot of, fortunately or unfortunately, there's also a lot of hype around some of this. Just given, your vantage point, and IBM is a renowned leader in this space, can you describe some of the things that that banks are doing in India to take advantage of what technology will permit them to do?
Yeah, I think, firstly, yes, it's no longer a hype for sure. A lot of banks present in this room, in this panel, I think they are doing some heartbreaking work in this area. IBM is doing a lot of work with them. I think the important thing is not about the different connotations of AI, cognitive, ML, etc., right? The important thing, the way to approach it, would really be look at the customer journey, finally. Then take a look at what are the various layers of your organization really fulfilling that customer journey. You will have your infrastructure, you will have your various data sources, then you will have your AI analytics, and then of course you will have your various customer engagement layers. It's important to take a look at that one journey, take a really hard look at how your AI could really make a difference, what kind of, and AI today is quite democratized if you really ask me. It's no longer one big monolithic machines. You have APIs available today for very, very specific functions of what an organization really wants to achieve. So a good idea would be to really look at one customer journey and look at each and individual layer and see how your data, what kind of inference you need to do on your data layer, what kind of inference you need to do on your AI layer. And this approach actually is getting adopted by a lot of companies and banks in India itself. We don't have enough to go beyond the shores of India.
Thank you, Arjit. You're very helpful in your perspective. Unless there are any other questions from the audience, I'll like to close the panel discussion. I'd like to thank all the panelists for making the time to be here and sharing their perspective. Thank you very much, everyone.